Have you ever wondered how many people in the world die each day? I read on wisevoter.com that there are about 150,000 deaths each day around the world. The writer of this particular article stated that these deaths happen for various reasons. They affect individuals, families, and communities in different ways, such as significant economic, social, and emotional impacts. I realize out of that 150,000 deaths, you and I will not know or remember very much about them. However, there is one death, folks, that affects all of us, and it is a death that we should remember. Furthermore, it is a death that we as believers will be thankful for all eternity. This death that I'm talking about is described in Mark chapter 15. Mark chapter 15. And here we have in this chapter the account concerning the death of Christ, the death of our Lord, the death of our Savior, the death of our Redeemer, the death of our risen and soon coming King. Let's look together in Mark chapter 15, and I want to begin by reading one verse, verse 37. I'm speaking on that subject, the death of Jesus Christ. Mark 15, verse 37, the Bible says, "And Jesus cried out with a loud voice and breathed his last breath." Here in chapter 15, at the beginning, Mark picks up early in the morning hours. Jesus has been with the chief priest and scribes, the whole Jewish council. They've been questioning Jesus. They have been examining Jesus. They have been falsely accusing Jesus. And now they bring Jesus to Pilate. Chapter 15 picks up with Jesus standing before Pilate. Pilate asking Jesus questions. And then Jesus being ordered to be led away and then crucified there on Golgotha. I want to present to you about the death of Jesus Christ several different aspects about it. And I pray that this sermon will cause each of us to remember what Jesus did for us, lead us to be thankful, and then cause each and every one of us to give the same devotion to Him that He gave to us. First of all, I notice in this chapter that Jesus died as a substitute. Jesus died as a substitute. In verses 6 through 15, the scriptures tell how that at this time it was the custom for the Roman leaders to release one of the prisoners that was going to be executed during the Passover time. And so Pilate has Barabbas, a man who was a rebel, a man who with a group of others led an insurrection, a man who is a criminal, a man who is a murderer. He's standing there, and also Jesus is standing there. And Pilate then asked the crowd of people, that mob that's there early in the morning hours, "Who do you want me to release for you?" And the crowd cries to crucify Jesus. Pilate then says in verse 14, "Wow, what evil has he done?" But the text says that this mob, this crowd continued to cry out, "Crucify him, crucify Jesus." And so Pilate, being a politician, being a man who wanted to please the people, being a man who wanted to hold his status in the Roman government. Instead of releasing Jesus, an innocent man, he releases, verse 15, to gratify the crowd, to please the people, he releases Barabbas. Instead of Jesus being released, Barabbas was released, and Jesus died in Barabbas's place. I read a story how during a war between Britain and France, how that a man was chosen to serve in the French army, and he refused to go by saying, "I was shot 2 years ago." And the military officers that came to draft him at first were puzzled and thought that maybe the man had lost his sanity. But the man kept insisting that this was his case. He told the military officers that the records would indicate that he was shot twice and killed in action. But these officers kept on questioning the man, so he told them how several years before he had been drafted, and a friend came to him saying, "I will take your name, I'll take your address, and I'll take your place in the French army since you are married and have a large family to care for." This is what the record will show. The army officials were puzzled. They went back and they went through the records, and sure enough, the man was telling the truth, and they went as far to speak to their leader, Napoleon Bonaparte, who decided that the country had no legal claim on this man. This man was free. He had died in a person of another. A substitute had died for him, as him, in his place. Folks, one of these days, unless the Lord returns in our lifetime, we will die. Our name will be called. But if we've placed our faith in Jesus Christ and repented of our sins, trusting that what Jesus did on the cross was for us in our place, then when our time comes to die, we may die that physical death, but not the second death. Because Jesus Christ died just as he did as a substitute for Barabbas. He died. He who knew no sin became sin for us. He died as our substitute. And then I see another aspect about our Lord's death in this chapter. He died in humiliation. The text picks up in verse 16 with the soldiers. He's just been scourged, verse 15 tells us. The idea of Jesus being scourged, the Romans would take an individual, they would strip them down. They would then tie their hands to a post above them. And then two army soldiers on each side would begin to whip that victim. Jesus was scourged. This whipping, the Jews only allowed up to 40 stripes, but the Romans had no limit at all. A painful, ruthless thing. Cicero, one Roman historian, says that very few people that were being ordered to be executed rarely made it to the cross beyond the scourging. Many of them were killed during that time. Verse 17, Jesus was led by these soldiers, and they placed a crown of thorns upon his head. Here, a man who came as king, he didn't receive a crown of gold in this life, but he received a crown of thorns. Verse 18 tells how that they mocked Jesus by sarcastically saying, "Hail, King of the Jews." Verse 19 tells how that they struck our Lord's head with a They struck his head with this reed. The text also tells us that they spat on Jesus. The scripture there in verse 19 tells us that they bowed before him, mocking and insulting him. Verse 20 tells us that they took the purple robe off of him. Now you must imagine he's been scourged. The flesh on his back has been torn open. He's been bleeding. This robe that he was wearing would already begin to dry like a bandage. And here they're ripping this robe off of him, exposing those open wounds again. Can you feel the pain? Then you skip down. He's hanging on the cross by this point, and people are passing by. They are blaspheming him. You see, Roman executions happened in public, just like when you watch a Western. And you know, when they have a hanging, all the town, they all gather out there to watch the hanging. Well, the crowd is there watching Jesus as he's hanging on the cross. People are passing by. They are shaking their heads at him. They're mocking and making fun of him. Verse 31 tells us how the chief priests, the religious people, they're there and they're watching and mocking Jesus as well. He saved others. Himself, he cannot save. And how true of a statement they made. Though he could have called down 10,000 angels, he had the power and the authority to do that in order to be our Savior, to save others, to save you and me. He had to allow himself to die this death. He died so that we could have forgiveness and eternal life, salvation. Verse 32 explains how that they mocked him because he claimed to be a king. In the chapter here, this whole chapter, if you read it when you go home, you'll find that this idea of Jesus being king, it's brought up several times in this chapter, and it's clear that Jesus, by his own people in the first century, he was the rejected king. You see, the first century Jewish people, the first century Jewish leaders, they wanted a political, national type king to rise up and to overthrow the Roman Empire, to set up a worldwide national political government there in Jerusalem. But Jesus came not to be a national or political king in this world. But as John 18:36, he says, "My kingdom is not of this world." He came not as a political and national king. He came as a spiritual and eternal king. King of the hearts of those who know him as Savior and Lord. And one day we'll enter into that eternal kingdom with him, to be with him forever. He was crucified. He died for sinners so that we could be saints. He bore our humiliation on the cross so that one day you and I would not be cast into hell to suffer the wrath of God forever, but be exalted and glorified with him and his eternal kingdom. Number three, I see in this chapter how that Jesus Christ died how? On a Roman cross. A Roman cross. The Jewish leaders, they had no authority to execute someone, so they brought Jesus to Pilate, a Roman authority. The Romans, they were the agents, the ones who crucified him. The Jews demanded it. The Romans were the agents that carried it out. They did the scourging. They did the crucifying. Jesus has been up all night. He has been questioned. He has been accused. He has been beat. He has been mocked. And now he's given a cross to carry up to this hill called Calvary. Jesus must have been tired. And so verse 21 tells us that these Roman soldiers compelled a certain man there, Simon, a man from Cyrene, the northern African region, modern day Libya. They compelled this man, a man who could have been of African descent. He could have been a Jewish man who lived there and came back to Jerusalem during this time of the Passover. But either way, he's compelled to take up this cross, to carry it and follow behind Jesus up this hill. Verse 22 tells us of the place where he was crucified, Golgotha, the place of a skull. Verse 23 tells us that they offered Jesus wine mingled with myrrh to drink, but he did not take it. In that day and time, sometimes they would offer the one going to the cross this mixture of wine and vinegar and herbs, almost like a sedative, to help them bear the pain and agony and torture. But Jesus refuses. In other words, he feels and he's going to experience the entirety of the death of the cross. Verse 24 tells how that the soldiers are there at the foot of the cross and they're gambling over his garments. Verse 25 tells us that they finally crucified him at the third hour. That would have been about 9 a.m. in the morning. The closest that we could understand the death of Jesus on the cross is through what we see on movies. But this only scratches the surface of the torture, the pain, and the agony that the death on a Roman cross caused. He was ordered to take this cross beam, to place it in the ground. They're there at Calvary. Jesus is quickly then thrown backwards. Think of this. His shoulders against the wood. The soldiers then feel for a depression in the front of his wrist. Then one of the soldiers takes a heavy square wrought iron nail and then begins to drive it through the wrist of Jesus and then deep into the wood on that cross. Quickly, that same soldier moves to the other side and repeats, being careful not to pull the arms of Jesus too tightly, but he leaves enough room for Jesus to have some movement on the cross. The cross is then lifted. It's put in its place there in the ground. The soldiers then take the left foot of Jesus and press it backward against the right foot of Jesus. And then with both feet extended, toes down, a nail is then driven through the arch of each feet. Jesus is now crucified. His body slowly sags down with more and more weight on the nails in his wrist, excruciating, fiery shoots of pain run along his fingers and up his arm to explode then in his brain. And Jesus is there as he's hanging on the cross. He's trying to push up on that nail that's got both of his feet to that cross. As he does that, excruciating pain is going through his feet, his ankles, agony, searing pain, and after a while, he's then too weak to push up anymore. He's still feeling the throbbing pain and cramps sweep over the muscles in his body. He's doing all that he can to bring in air, to breathe into his lungs. He gets to a point where he can still take in a little bit of air, but he can't hardly expel it. So carbon dioxide is building up in his lungs. Finally, there is a crushing pain that begins to build in his chest. His blood has started to thicken. He can't breathe. And finally, he cries out with a loud voice and breathes his last breath. Jesus died an agonizing death on the cross. Jesus died forsaken by the Father, verses 33 through 34. He died a literal, actual death, verse 37 tells us. Now, I know that there are some that have bought into the swoon theory that as Jesus hung on that cross, he didn't completely die. And after he was taken down from the cross, the swoon theory says that he was placed in this cool tomb, and there his body was covered with these medicinal spices, and then after resting a while, his body revives. But listen, the Romans, they knew how to execute somebody, and they knew when they had done their job, and they knew if he was really dead or not. He literally died. He breathed his last breath, verse 37 says. He tasted death for every man. Verse 38 tells us that he died a death of accomplishment. After Jesus breathes his last breath on the cross, do you see what happens? Mark gives us just a little detail. Matthew gives us more information. Mark said in verse 38, then the veil of the temple, that veil that separated the Holy of Holy place from the rest of the temple, no one could enter that place except for the high priest. They could only enter that place at a certain time, only with blood. They could only access the presence of God. The people had to have a mediator. But here Jesus Christ, when he dies on the cross, he accomplishes eternal salvation and eternal atonement for all sin. Now Jesus is the sacrifice. Jesus is our high priest. No more sacrifices. No more earthly priest. Judgment has now come on the temple system of Judaism. God the Father rent the veil of that temple from the top to the bottom, the text says. Only he could do that. Showing that you and I have access to the presence of God, access for forgiveness, access for salvation, access for an eternal personal relationship with God. And now Christ, the great high priest, has entered into that eternal temple in heaven. And there he is with the Father. And when you and I believe, you and I also become a part of that eternal temple. The body of Christ and his presence now doesn't necessarily dwell. It doesn't dwell in an earthly holy of holy place. His presence dwells in our hearts. Hallelujah. Lifted up was he to die. It is finished, was his cry. now in heaven exalted high, hallelujah, what a Savior. When he comes, our glorious King, all his ransom here to bring, then a new song we will sing, hallelujah, what a Savior. And then finally, I want to point out to you how that Jesus died a compelling death. A death that is remembered, a death that impacts everyone in some way. Notice verse 39. There is a centurion standing there, a Roman soldier. He wasn't the average Roman soldier. He was a Roman soldier who had men serving under him, a man of position, a man of rank, a man who had saw many people suffer, many people die. Most likely that was one of his jobs, to be an executioner. He understood what it was to watch someone suffer on the cross. But when Jesus suffered, when Jesus took insults, when Jesus died, this centurion was so moved because he had never seen anybody die like this before. The text tells us that after Jesus breathed his last breath, this centurion was so touched, was so moved deep within his heart. A man who would normally have a calloused and a cold and a heart of stone, his heart is touched, his heart is broken. And God gives him a new heart, and he believes on Jesus to be the Son of God. Says, this is the Son of God. He's compelled to believe. But then also at the cross, there's some more people there. Look at verses 40 through 41. All of the other disciples have ran away except for John. And here we see that there's a group of women. There's Mary Magdalene. There's Mary, the mother of James, the less. There's Salome. These women followed him. They ministered to him. And here they're standing afar. There's the crowd in between them, and they're remaining devoted to Jesus. I want to ask you, when you think of what Jesus did for you by coming into this earth, by living a sinful, sinless life, by dying on a cross for you and me, by being buried and rising from the grave, I don't know about you, but that not only makes me want to believe in him, that makes me want to devote every part of my being to him. Here these women are remaining devoted to Jesus. That's how they're compelled. And then in verses 42 through 46, we're reminded of another person at the cross, Joseph of Arimathea. In another scripture, it tells us that he was a secret disciple. But here this man who was a secret disciple, he kept it under wraps, his belief in Christ, his devotion to Christ. And the other gospel tells us that Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus were so compelled that they had to come public with their faith in Jesus Christ and do something great for Jesus. And here Joseph of Arimathea, he goes and he asks for the body of Jesus. And then he buries him in his tomb. You see, the death of Jesus should touch me. It should touch you. How should it touch you and me? It should cause us to believe in him. Nobody like him has ever died for us. We should believe in him as Savior and as Lord and as soon coming King. We should remain devoted to him in this life, being willing to stand by him and follow him and obey him and be loyal to him, no matter the cost, no matter what we may face in this life. And it should cause us, just like Joseph of Arimathea, to be willing to be public and bold about our faith in Christ, no matter the cost. At the cross where I first saw the light and the burden of my heart rolled away, it was there by faith that I received my sight, and now I'm happy all the day. Well, this is what Jesus did for you. This is what Jesus did for me. I want to ask you this morning, are you thankful? Are you thankful for what Jesus did for you? He didn't die as a martyr. He didn't die as a good example. He died as our Savior. He died the death that we should have died. Now, I know there's some that say, I should have been crucified, and there's a song. But you know what? If you and I had been nailed to the cross, it wouldn't have done me or you or anybody any good. It took the sinless Lamb of God. And hallelujah, what a Savior. Let's stand to our feet. If God spoke to your heart this morning and you need to be saved, I want to invite you to come as we sing. And I'd love to pray with you and show you how you can be saved. If you need assurance of your salvation, you're not sure that you're saved, I invite you to come. Let me talk with you and pray with you. If you want to rededicate your life to Jesus Christ this morning, I invite you to come. Step out of that seat and walk down the aisle to do that. If God's speaking to your heart and you really don't know what to do, you come. You come. Meet me here at the front, and I'll do my best to minister to you as God's dealing with your heart. Let's sing. What number?
Page 307, just as I am.
307, you come.
Just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst me come to thee, O Lamb of God, I come.
We're going to sing one more verse.
Just as I am and waiting not to rid my soul of one dark blot, to thee whose blood can cleanse each spot, O Lamb of God, I come.
Have you done everything that God has spoke to your heart about doing this morning? Has He asked you to do something as you leave? Do it. He gave His all for us. And in response, we should give Him our all. Amen. Let's be dismissed.